Hello everybody, and welcome back to episode 2 of our map making adventure. So last episode we made this timer over here. We started working on this one and then I had to get going, but I did work on it some more. I think I got something pretty decent here using cows. There's fences below the water that takes the cows through, and there's cobwebs to slow them down. And then fences next to it with pressure plates above, which will activate the lights on the way. So all in all, this is how it works. And then we can see from this side, the cow slowly trickles his way down. And we should be able to continue this as long as we want to get whatever time we want. We have a nice visual display, how much time is left. After recording this clip, I'm going to look at this in my editor and figure out exactly how long it takes the cow to travel one block through this contraption. Now, an important thing with this is it seems to prevent the cow's pathfinding from taking or being able to work, which is really, really important. Because otherwise, like, you could walk a little bit to the right, and then he wouldn't be touching the pressure plates, or he could try to fight the stream or go that way, and it would affect the timing. But I think, pretty sure, he's just standing there, which is good. We can get precise timing that way. I did mess around a little bit with slow sand, and I could not notice any effect with it. I tried placing it above and also below. So the cow should be where the slow sand is. And it seems to move at the same speed. I might check this too with my editor, just to be sure. Maybe it is slower. It's hard to tell. And yeah, can't really put it below because I need the fence thing to prevent the pathfinding. Anyway, I'm going to check this, figure out the timings, and then I'll know how long I need to make it. I looked at the timings a little bit, and it seems like it's 15.9 seconds per block that the cow travels. That includes with the slow sand. With one of the cases, though, it was 15.6 seconds, so I'll have to test this a little further to be sure. And I'm trying to think about how long I actually want this timer. Originally I thought 5 minutes, but I'm thinking shorter might be better actually. Because this timer is for a waiting room to start the match. What I'm going to have in my arena is a day-night sensor. At nighttime, once the sensor picks that up, that it's nighttime, it's going to trigger this timer for kind of like a final countdown to start the match. Then when the cow gets to the end here, he will trigger a pressure plate or something. I'll probably also have lava to kill it. Probably floating up right where this block is or something. Might have to change this with nether brick if I use lava. Nether brick fences. So yeah, once the cow makes it to the end, the match will start. Players will get transported into the arena. We'll have to use some command blocks to do that. And also, I should probably be pretty careful about making this stuff player proof as best as I can. So instead of having the pressure plates right next to the lamps here, it's probably better to do something like this. Use bedrock as much as I can. Make it go through a full block so TNT won't be able to get to the circuitry. I don't want people being able to tamper with the timings of things, because that would be a big problem. I am, like, this map I'm making, I'm intending it for us minecrackers and just people in general who want to have a fun time. but it occurred to me that people might actually want to play this competitively, kind of like how Race for Wool tournaments started, where rules are really important. Why can't I find my, what am I looking for? Lamps. So, if people do use my map, I should make sure it's as player-proof as possible, so that would work out better. Stuck in the cobwebs. Yeah, it works. Actually, I could just use a cow. Why am I testing it myself when I have it set up? Yeah. Anyway, let's move on for the main project I wanted to do today, the capture node room. Right, so the logic to this again, this will be for a waiting room timer. Pe the players will be in a little room. Each team will have their own room, I think. When this counts down to the very end, the match will start. The players will transport into the arena to fight. Also, this thing is going to trigger this timer. It'll reset it. And then this thing's going to start counting down. After just about 5 minutes, it will trigger another thing, sudden death. And its sudden death is what we need the capture nodes for. If for some reason the match is taking a long time and maybe it's entered into a stalemate or something, there's going to be a second winning condition where players will be able to stand on like a pressure plate for a certain amount of time, and then they'll win the match, and the other team will have to try and knock them off of it. Both teams will have their own pressure plates that they need to stand on. They'll probably be fairly close to each other as well. So if one guy is on this one, he can still shoot at the guy on the other one. But I'm not going to be using pressure plates actually. I'm going to do something like this where I'll just set this up as layers. Let's pretend this first layer is the arena floor. Then somewhere underground, there's going to be a bedrock barrier so that the players won't be able to get into the circuitry. And then below the bedrock barrier, there will be, give Etho 521. There will be a mob spawner of some sort. So if the player is above that mob spawner within a certain radius, maybe like a 3x3 area or something, I'll probably try to set up. Then it will start spawning something that despawns quickly on top of a pressure plate underground. So otherwise, the pressure plates could be destroyed by players pretty easily, intentionally or not. So anyway, basically there's going to be two pressure plates, and I want to figure out the logic behind how we're going to rig this up. So one for each team. Yeah, the first thing we'll probably want to do is check that we're in sudden death. We don't want them to be able to win using these if it's not sudden death. So when that thing counts down to the end, it will probably s hey, get out of here. We'll probably set up an RS NOR latch that it'll trigger like that. We got buttons. So it'll trigger an RS NOR latch. Then we need to set up AND gates for each of these. I think we can do it pretty simply, like this. They can both share this one wire because they're both checking the same thing if it's in sudden death. See, we'll put that there and that there. Yeah, so that one turned on and that one turned on. So only if we're in sudden death, power will be able to get through. If this is not in sudden death, it'll be like this. Step on the pressure plate, that torch does not come on now. And same with this one. So that's our first check. Actually, you know what else we should do? When we get to sudden death, this RSNOR latch is going to trigger. We'll want it to turn on some lights and maybe trigger some note blocks when that happens, so that the players know we're in sudden death. They will, of course, be able to see it by looking at that, but it would be good to have some lights and some note blocks next to these capture nodes too. So I'm just going to put these here as a reminder so that when we do our actual arena build, I won't forget to include these somehow. So, note blocks and lights. All right. Let's see. Yeah, I just want to work out some of the more technical stuff before we actually start building. I thought of one other thing I might want to plan out before we start building. I need some way of detecting when a win happens. With the game style I'm doing, again, I don't want to spoil too much. It's going to be really difficult because there can be any number of players involved. So I think I need a counter to check how many players before the match starts. So when they're teleported into the arena, they need to add one to a counter. Each guy that teleports, and then as they die, I'm going to set their spawn into a like something that will detect their death, and then that'll remove one from the counter. And then when it hits zero, we know the game is over for one of the teams, and then we can see who won by that. So I might want to plan that out too before we start actually building the arena, which we should do soon. Otherwise, we're just going to do a technical builds and nothing's ever going to get done. Okay, so anyway, next thing we will want to do is go into some sort of a timer here. So, trying to decide how I want these capture nodes. I think I talked to Seth Bling about it, and he used minecarts for his capture nodes in Team Fortress 2. We might do that. Trying to decide, like, if a player gets knocked off the capture node, do we want it to reset, or do we just want total time player is on to trigger a win? Not sure. In Team Fortress 2, Seth did it where if they get knocked off, it gets reset. I guess I might just do whatever's easiest. I don't know exactly how I'm doing the timers, if I'm using minecarts or not. I did not see how he did his. I might download the map and check. He said it would be okay if I used it with mine. Actually, I'm going to mess with the redstone one first. It's pretty important that these are precise timings. We will want visual indicators as well, so maybe he had five lights in his map that come on one after another. So we might want to do that too. Something people can see. And audio. Audio too, of course. Let's see. I'm going to mess with some stuff off camera for a bit. Try to figure out something that works. Okay, well, I did take a look at the Team Fortress 2 map at one of the capture nodes, and it was not what I was expecting. I didn't see any minecart timer or anything. It looked like it was all redstone. The redstone was pretty confusing because it's all mixed together with other parts of the map, it looks like. So we'll leave that as a just in case we can't figure something out here, because I think it'll take me a while to break it into something I can use. But I was messing around and I came up with this, and this might work. We'll have to make a few adjustments, but basically it's this a chain of redstone repeaters, and they are weaving through the pistons. And when the pistons go up, they're held up by this, and then that will go up to our lights and our note blocks and all that. There's a reset here, which is good. We need to be able to reset it. I decided I'm going to make it like in the Team Fortress 2 map, where if you get knocked off, it resets. So that'll work. work out better, I think. What I gotta do though is stop this chain from continuing if I'm off the pressure plate. Like right now it's going. If I try to reset it, you can't really. It just keeps going. So gotta find a way to break it, and that's what I'm gonna work on now. Well, I'll show you something else I tried here. It's not quite working, but it's closer. I got these all set in 1 second now. The problem is it's still doing this chain thing. I set up this row of pistons below as a way of breaking that, but it's not going down if the repeaters are powered. Which means if we if we go off and on, it can create some weird results. So, the pressure plate, it goes down to that line below. It also goes up to the reset. This is the issue here. If we have a piston like this and we're powering it from above, you can't retract it. That's what I'm using to keep the memory up here. That's a good thing. But for the pistons below, it's not a good thing because I can't retract the blocks. If we do a sideways piston thing, though, we can, because it doesn't actually power the piston if it's going into that block. So we may have to try rig it up that way or just do something else totally. Okay, I just put this together real quick. It's a little silly, but I think it would actually work. I don't know if I'll use it, but pressure plate goes to this clock. When you stand on it, the clock is active. That goes to this piston, which pushes sand in front of these repeaters. And then the repeaters power whatever we want. And then the pressure plate also goes to a reset line. And if we had a mob spawner that spawns sand in for us, like an infinite supply, it would work, I think. It's a little silly. Don't know. I'm having trouble with this, actually. I'm gonna keep working at it for a little bit more here. Might have to sleep on it. But this does work. Ooh, check it out, man. I was playing some Nail tonight with the guys, and last username showed me this. This is really cool approach to it. It's got a good reset. Very simple. No pistons. Yeah, so I think that's what we're going to do. I've tried to make it work with a longer delay because I think I want either a 10 or a 15 second time that you need to stand on the pressure plate. So I got this set up. Yeah, this is about 10 seconds, just a little bit under. Works pretty good. I'm having a few issues. I might have set something up wrong. I'll have to play with it a bit. You see, when I stepped on it again, it's doing this weird flashing thing now. So I'll have to try to get rid of that, but I think we could use this for our display. I'll just have to try get it all together, like instead of having the five wires this spaced out this much, we'll want them all together. So in the end, we end up with just redstone torches underneath five lamps like this. But anyway, I'm going to mess around with it some more on my own time. I think I'm going to get going for today. I hope you enjoyed this episode, and we will continue on next time.